Good morning. Today is April 5th, 2020. This one of the highlights on our church calendar. Today is Palm Sunday. Today is a day we recognize the entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. We'll talk more about that, of course. If you're here today as a visitor watching us, we want to give you a special welcome today. We do extend a hearty welcome to those watching this service that are visiting with us. I do hope that you plan to see us in person one of these days when that resumes for us down the road. Announcements first, to call to your attention. Our book study will continue to meet 5:30 on Wednesday. We'll meet again by FaceTime, and I'll contact those in the group about that. Next Sunday is Easter Sunday, so please plan to be part of this service next Sunday. The highlight, of the church year. Easter Sunday is next Sunday. And so now, friends, with all that being said, let us worship God together. We come to our prayer time this morning because we are people of prayer. Prayer is the one thing that connects us, yes, to God, of course, but also to one another. When we are in need, we turn to God in prayer. We have concerns for our friends and family. We pray for them. These prayers work. They have a positive effect in the lives of those we pray for. We give God our concerns. We give to God our joys. Our prayer list this week, just to share some updates with you, we do want to add to our prayer list the Ewing family, We will add Leisha's friend April to our prayer list. We'll also add Vern's sister Margaret, who works with coronavirus patients in the healthcare system. And of course, all those around us that are impacted still by social distancing as a result of the attempts to combat the coronavirus. On the joy side, we have no birthdays this week. We had a lot last week, but none this week. And so with our joys and concerns, let us now go to God in prayer together as a church family. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for this day that you have made. Indeed, a beautiful day that you've blessed us with. We give you thanks that we could gather either at home or in front of a screen with just us and your presence alone. But we gather nonetheless. We gather as a family of faith. We gather as visitors. We gather as people proclaiming the gospel message. We know that your message is one that the world so desperately needs to hear, this day's especially, a message of hope, of grace. As we go through forth our days, Lord God, remind us that indeed we are here to serve you, to worship you, to praise your name, who has done so much for us. And especially now in these times of difficulty, we turn to you anew and again, knowing full well that you will be here with us. We pray for our prayer list, the friends of ours, our church family members who need your assistance. We lift up Eleanor and Georgia Lou and Linda and the Ewing family and Leisha's friend April and Vern's sister Margaret. We pray for those both here, across the state, the nation, and the globe, all who are affected by social distancing, by illnesses from the coronavirus, from all the effects of what this has done to us as a people. We pray that you uplift those that are down, that you give to those who need it most that peace that passes our human understanding. We know that you are with us, Lord God, and that's why we're still joyful people today, still able to celebrate and lift up the praises to you. We thank you today for those that are watching, for those that are perhaps watching for the first time this particular church and the service here. We ask your blessing upon our visitors. We ask that you bless those doing your work today. We give thanks and ask your blessing upon the leadership team of this church who does so much behind the scenes. We thank you today and lift up praise for Jackson, Leisha, Morgan, and Chadwick. Yes, we are thankful people for many reasons. But as always, we thank you most of all today. Most of all, for your Son, Jesus Christ, the one who came into Jerusalem with palm branches laid in front of him, and the one who taught us to pray this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Well, today is Palm Sunday, a day that begins a week that we refer to as Holy Week. It's a week that started out on Palm Sunday with Jesus standing up on a high hill overlooking the city of Jerusalem. It's much the same way that I'm standing right here on this hill overlooking our town of Glasgow, Kentucky. I look behind me at the town and I know that today on this Palm Sunday, the town is in a bit of a somber mood, rightly so. There's a number of downtown churches behind me that usually they would have a full parking lot today. They would have children carrying palm branches such as these. They would have choirs processing into the choir loft down the aisle on most Palm Sundays, but not today. In fact, the courthouse behind me, which on a normal Monday tomorrow will be full of activity, tomorrow there will not be business as usual. This is a somber scene on this hill over this town. But you know, as Jesus approached Jerusalem from the hillside, it was a somber scene then too. The same way Jesus entered Jerusalem, he walked down into town with palm branches laid in front of him and shouts of Hosanna in the highest heaven. But he knew then that on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday that he would be teaching, preaching, sharing the gospel in the city, downtown Jerusalem. He also knew that on Thursday he would be betrayed. And he knew on Friday he would be executed. Indeed, as Jesus was on top of the hill looking down into Jerusalem, he wept. He wept and had lots of concern for the city, the same way we have lots of concern for this city today on this hill. But the story of Palm Sunday is this. It's a story that will begin and end in palm branches and in victory. Friends, we return down from the hills around our city of Glasgow, Kentucky, back to our downtown sanctuary here at First Presbyterian Church. As we gather back here in this sanctuary, we're going to take a look at what happened to Jesus during Holy Week, one event in particular when Jesus entered into town. We're going to be introduced to a man named Barabbas. And if you're home now, as you are home, please go ahead and find your home Bible. I'm going to tell you in advance, we're going to Matthew's Gospel. We're going to Matthew chapter 27. So please, as I find it in mine, I encourage you to find it in yours. Matthew chapter 27. We're going to read an account of what happened in Holy Week in Jerusalem between Jesus, Pilate, the chief priests, the elders, and Barabbas. And we don't know much about Barabbas. There's a lot of tradition outside of the Bible that gives us information about Barabbas, but the Bible itself doesn't say much. We do know that Barabbas was a criminal of some kind. He was a famous criminal. We're told that he was notorious. So let's see what happened with Barabbas, Jesus, Pilate, the chief priest, and the elders. Matthew 27, we're going to read verses 11 through 23. 11 through 23, we're going to read it straight through. Are you with me? Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor wondered greatly. Now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted. And they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him. She says, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much over him today in a dream." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the people to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus who is called Christ?" They all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." You know, the prophet Isaiah tells us that the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord shall stand forever. Amen. You know, friends, what started as a victory on the hills outside of Jerusalem with palm branches ended up in what we just read. It ended up with Barabbas and Jesus. See, the chief priests and the elders of the town wanted Jesus dead. We know that. And I'm going to give the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, some credit here. Pilate saw right through this. He knew full well that the chief priests and the elders in the town wanted Jesus gone because they were envious of him. They were jealous of his following. Pilate saw it clearly. And as a matter of fact, as we read there, even Pilate's wife came to the governor and said, "I've got a bad feeling about this. This is a righteous man that they want to get rid of," right? And so the stage is set. And Pilate puts the decision on what happens to Jesus back on the people, back on the chief priests and the elders. For there was a custom in that day that the governor would release one prisoner whom the people wanted. And so Pilate puts the decision back on the people. Pilate says, "Do you want me to release Barabbas? Or do you want me to release Jesus, who you call the Christ?" Now, when Pilate asked the crowd that question, the chief priests and the elders of the town had already worked the crowd. We are told that the crowd had already been persuaded to ask for Barabbas. Now, I don't know what kind of persuasion that was. Maybe the chief priests and the elders threatened the crowd that they had better choose Barabbas. Or maybe the chief priests and the elders bribed the crowd, paid them money to ask for Barabbas. Maybe there was a show of force there of some kind to reinforce the decision to ask for Barabbas. But nonetheless, we do know the chief priests and the elders persuaded that crowd through some means to ask for Barabbas, and that they did. They said to Pilate, "Give us Barabbas." They all said it. And when Pilate says to the crowd, "What about Jesus, who you call the Christ?" You know what, friends? There was not one person, not one in that crowd, who said, "Give us Jesus, who is the Christ." Can you imagine Jesus there in that moment, the entirety of the crowd asking for Barabbas, and not one asking for him? Yes, friends, those chief priests and elders did their job very well, intimidated or persuaded the crowd so that, as we read, everyone in the crowd, when Pilate said, "What about Jesus?" everyone said, "Crucify him." And even Pilate was taken aback by that response, that no one would speak for Jesus. For Pilate says in the scriptures, he says, "Why? What evil has this man done?" And yet once again, everyone says, "Crucify him." Not one spoke on his behalf. I want to pause there for a minute and leave this gospel lesson to say that I read in the local media here a couple days ago, I think it was in the Thursday newspapers, that our local school boards and school administrators have talked about graduation for our high school seniors at Barron County and Glasgow High School. And these school boards and administrators have said that there will be a graduation. Somehow, someplace, somewhere, some way, these seniors will be honored locally. And I was so glad to see that. It's comforting to know that we have such a wonderful set of educators, administrators, and school board members to look out for the needs of our high school seniors. But when I read that, I was reminded about my very own high school graduation, Warren East High School, just down the street from here. A month before our graduation, my senior class got news that our graduation venue had been changed. We were supposed to go to Diddle Arena for graduation. But a month before graduation, we heard that the principal announced we were going to go instead for graduation to Western Kentucky University's Ag Expo Center. That's where it would be. Well, two of my senior classmates discovered that the day before the graduation, there was a rodeo scheduled at the Ag Expo Center. And so they didn't like the fact that we would be following up a rodeo with our graduation. So two of my classmates started a petition to petition the principal to find a new venue for our graduation, that we didn't want to go behind the rodeo. We wanted a different location. And so every senior in the senior class signed that petition, including me. The two that started it were friends of mine, and we all thought the same thing. You know, who wants to follow the rodeo, right, at graduation? So we all signed it. Anyway, the last day of school comes, and we're in the gymnasium for graduation practice or graduation run-through. The senior class is there. And in walks the principal to the last day of school where we're practicing for graduation. The principal has in his hand rolled up the petition. And let me tell you, on good days, he was in a bad mood. He was in a real foul mood this day. And he looked at the senior class there in the gymnasium, petition in his hand to have it somewhere else besides the Expo Center. And the principal says to us, "I thought you all wanted to graduate tomorrow." He said to us, "Your courageous to sign this. Tell me to my face right here who wants to have graduation somewhere else, and we'll talk more about it in my office." Well, no one stood up to say a word. We all were quiet. And after that was finished, as we decompressed as a senior class, we all thought the same thing. It's the last day of school. We're not going to jeopardize going back to start 12th grade again over this, right? He says, if we want to graduate, that seemed to me we should keep quiet if we want our diploma. And the more we talked about it as a senior class, we would have had graduation in a cow pasture if we had to, just to get that diploma. It was the last day of school. And I thought about that when I heard the story of the graduations here. And I thought about that when I read about how the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd that day to go along with a little intimidation with it, right? And that gives us the lesson for today. That gives us our Palm Sunday lesson. As we leave our homes and go into the world, the extent that we do, either physically or by social media, remember this. We are the ones that are called to be today the voice of Jesus Christ. We're the ones that are called to shout for Jesus, right? We shout the message of grace, hospitality, love, forgiveness, inclusion. We give this gospel message today. We shout it out. But as we are reminded in this passage, it's a vivid reminder to us that sometimes it takes a lot of courage to be the voice that shouts, "Give me Jesus Christ." Sometimes we'll have to stand up to the powers that be. And standing up to power does take a lot of courage. It's a courage that nobody had when Pilate asked Barabbas or Jesus. In our own walk with Jesus Christ, may we find that courage when the time calls for it, to be people, despite being persuaded to keep quiet, despite being intimidated to look the other way. May we say no loud and clear. We shout, give us Jesus, who is the Christ. And likewise, when the entire crowd goes one way, when the entire crowd moves away from Jesus to somebody else, may we also have the courage to be, even if we're the lone voice, the only one that says, no, I want Jesus, who is the Christ. Today in this gospel lesson, we get a lesson about speaking up for the one who speaks so loudly for us, to the one that has given us everything. From time to time, we'll have to speak for Jesus, even shout, even in the face of being persuaded not to, even when the entire crowd goes the other way, even when your very own diploma from 12th grade may be on the line, right? We all have times in our life when these moments come, and may we be people who with courage never fail to say, I'll take Jesus, who is the Christ. Let us pray together. We thank you, Lord, for this Palm Sunday. For indeed, Palm Sunday is a day of victory. We know that Christ was victorious when he walked in Jerusalem and victorious when he ascended out. We ask today, though, that as we're reminded of the victory in Jesus, that we receive courage from your Spirit. For we know that so often it takes a lot of courage in this day and age, in fact, in every day and age, to be people that shout for Jesus Christ, even when the powers that be persuade us to look the other way, even when the entire crowd says something different. May we be unlike the world, Lord God, today, and be people who, loud and clear, always say, yes, we'll take Jesus. Thank you very much. In his name we pray. Amen. As we conclude our service time today, friends, I do want to say a word about the church and offerings. The needs of the church do continue. I mentioned last Sunday that, in fact, our expenses are up a bit. We've had to invest in equipment and the means through which we can bring you these messages through our YouTube channel. We have applied for an online giving ability through the Presbyterian Foundation. That's in the works. As you might guess, a lot of churches also have applied to the Presbyterian Foundation for online giving abilities. So it's coming. In the meantime, the church has set up a PayPal account. If you want to contribute to our PayPal account to this church on a temporary basis until our permanent account is established, that PayPal account information may be on the video you're watching now. It certainly will be on our website and those places. Please consider the church, and of course, mail a check if you prefer that. Our address is 200 East Washington Street, Glasgow, Kentucky, 42141. Friends, go forth today. Have courage. Be brave. No matter who persuades us to be quiet, no matter what the entire crowd does, may we always be people that proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each of you this day and always. Mm-hmm.